Listening Library presents The Great Trouble, The Mystery of London, The Blue Death, and A Boy Called Eel by Deborah Hopkinson. Read for you by Matthew Frow with Kimberly Farr. Part 1. Mudlark. There is another class who may be termed river finders. They are commonly known by the name of mudlarks. They may be seen of all ages, crawling among the barges at the various wharfs along the river. They are scarcely half covered by the tattered, indescribable things that serve them for clothing. Henry Mayhew, London Labour and the London Poor, 1851. Chapter 1. River Finders. 1854. Monday, August 28th. What we now call the Great Trouble began one thick, hot, foul-smelling morning in August. Course, I didn't know it then. No one did. I remember that day for quite another reason. I was supposed to be dead. But, somehow, he had found me out. It was early and dark enough that most mudlarks weren't on the river yet. I liked this time best. The stink wasn't quite so bad for some reason. And it was quiet, since most folks in London were still sleeping. The bustle and noise of the old city would start up soon enough. Thumbless Jake was there, of course. The rest of us scavengers wondered if he ever did sleep. And on this particular morning, Jake was on edge. I expect because of spending so much time wading in that sludgy stink we called a river. So, when he spied me snatching up something shiny from the murky water, he commenced hollering like a mad bull about to charge. And I should know. I might never have been on a farm in all my nearly 13 years, but I'd seen my share of raging beasts at the old Smithfield livestock market, a fearful but exciting place. They'd moved it 2 years before, on account of the mayhem caused by throngs of cattle, pigs, goats, horses and sheep tramping through the heart of the city. I was sad to see it go.
"Give it here, Eel!"
Jake shouted at once. He thrust out his long stick and lunged for my ankles. "Can't catch me," I taunted. I skittered out of reach, fast as I could, sticky brown mud squelching between my toes. "Don't be greedy, it's just a bit of rope."
"Lawyer, tain't rope at all. I seen it glitter with me own eyes. That's copper you got there."
Thumbless Jake pointed the forefinger of his right hand, his good one, at me.
"Play fair, Eel."
"Why should I? No one's ever played fair with me." I said it, but that wasn't quite true. Even Jake himself had once done me a good deed.
"Wicked ungrateful lad,"
Jake growled, aiming a huge hunk of spit at me. Jake had been a blacksmith once, or so I'd heard from Ned. We called him Nasty Ned, on account of him being the worst-smelling lad on the river.
"Jim was Jake's downfall,"
Ned had told me.
"And then came the day he tippled so much, he slammed a great hammer down on his own thumb."
I tried to picture Jake's muscles, as they must have been, rippling across his back like ever so many snakes. These days, he used his arms for stealing copper off the hulls of ships and trolling for bits of the shiny stuff in the brown slop of low tide.
"You are an eel,"
Jake declared. He paused to wipe his face with a corner of his ragged shirt, though I'm not sure why, as both were equally covered in filth.
"Slippery and more hard-hearted than most, and that's saying a lot, with this here pack of mudlarks."
"I'll take that as a compliment," I grinned.
"Hand it over. You're poached on my bit of river here,"
Jake said, his voice almost pleading now.
"You gotta stay on the edge. Them's the rules, lad."
You're always going on about rules, Jake. I was bluffing, though, and Jake knew it. In the end, I'd have to give in. A big man like Jake could troll where he wanted. Kids like me had to keep to the edge of the grimy brown river, picking up pieces of coal, rope, rags and wood at low tide. On a good day, I might collect enough coal to fill a pot and make a penny. Now that I had my place at the Lion Brewery over on Broad Street, I'd been mudlarking mostly just in the early mornings, when it was so hot even my stone cellar room seemed about to stifle me. It didn't bring in much, but I needed any extra tin I could get.
Have a heart, Eel.
Jake fixed me with his wild blue eyes and tried again.
Ain't we all river finders? Put on this earth to try to get by one day at a time? We're all we've got under this sky. We need to play fair and take care of one another. If I'd known that sooner, I wouldn't have lost sweet Hazel and my kiddies.
He went on, almost to himself, slapping the oily surface of the water with his stick. All right, I relented at last. You win. It's yours. Catch! The big man lunged and missed, landing flat on his face, sputtering in the churning black water. I laughed and turned to go. But Jake had the last word.
You better watch out, Eel!
He rose up, hollering at the top of his lungs.
He's been nosing around asking after you, he has. Don't blame me. I had nothing to do with it. But he says a little birdie told him you ain't dead.
What? I froze, digging my feet into the mud. What did you say?
You heard me, lad. You think you're clever, but just you watch out.
Jake warned.
I ain't let on I knows anything about you, but Fisheye Bill Tyler is on to you, and a nastier man never walked the streets of London. He might have been an honest fishmonger once. Those days are gone. He's turned bad. Very bad indeed.
What did he say, Jake? I demanded.
Why, Eel, he only wants what's his,
Jake replied, trying to wipe streaks of dark mud from his grizzled face, this time with his fingers.
Fisheye said he just wants what belongs to him by rights.
Jake hadn't touched a hair on my head, but it felt as though he'd knocked the breath right out of me. You ain't seen me, Jake, I cried. You hear me? You know nothing. All you know is that the Thames got me. I took a ragged breath, the stink of the river almost making me retch. You got that? I'm dead. Carried out to sea in the arms of this muddy flow. Dead and gone.
What did you take of his Eel? You must have done something to make him that mad.
Jake called, holding fast to the scrap of copper he'd finally fished out of the grimy water. I took off. My insides had begun to shake like the last little leaf on a tree when the cold fingers of a biting wind come to snatch it. How had he found me out? I'd made sure that Fisheye had been told I was dead, swallowed up by the dirty old river, covered by its churning waters. For the last 6 months, I'd kept low and out of his way, and I'd kept my secret safe. Until now. How much did Fisheye know? And who had snitched? It might have been Jake himself. Trust was as rare on the river as finding a gold ring. No, I couldn't trust him. Thumbless Jake was right about one thing, though. Fisheye Bill Tyler wanted to control whatever he thought belonged to him. Pickpockets, petty thieves, housebreakers, and me. Chapter 2, in which I save a pathetic creature. I stormed away, sweating, grimy and wet. You might say I was mired in my own murky thoughts. Next thing I knew, I almost had my head taken off by something hurtling down from the sky, aimed right at me.
Hello, Eel!
a voice called.
Watch out!
I jumped back. At first, I was afraid the stone arch above me had chosen this day to crumble into the river. Everyone knew Blackfriars Bridge wouldn't last much longer without repairs. But stones didn't screech like the ear-splitting sound that filled the air.
Yow!
Splash!
For you, eel!
I looked up. Only one mudlark had orange hair.
What are you torturing now, Ned?
Before me, the strange creature yowled again, making wild splashes as it struggled to stay afloat. All at once, it disappeared. The tide was coming up now, and I lunged, moving into the flow of the river.
Let it be, why don't you? Ned.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.